با عرض درود و سلام گرم به شما بینندگان محترم، نوید محمدزاده هستم با زنگ سلامت شماره 200. خب امیدوارم هر جا هستین شاد و تندرست باشین. در این برنامه به یه سری از موضوعات دیگه در رابطه با مدیریت و ارگانهای مختلف فیزیوتراپی میپردازیم و برای اینکه بهترین استفاده رو ببریم یه مهمان خیلی ویژه‌ای داریم که خانم کرن میدلتون هستن، پروفسور کرن میدلتون، و بنده ناچاراً انگلیسی این برنامه را اجرا خواهم کرد که برای شما عزیزان ترجمه میشه و امیدوارم که بهترین استفاده را هر جا هستین ببرید. خب now let's switch to English. I welcome you all to TV program زنگ سلامت. I hope wherever you are enjoy your life and try to keep fit with some regular exercise and other physical activity. Today's show is about management and governance of physiotherapy. Therefore, to have a best program, I have invited one of the special guests, Professor Karen Middleton, who is Chief Executive of Chartered Society of Physiotherapy. Karen, very welcome to our shows. If you don't mind, please introduce yourself, and then we're going to have a brief talk about different issues.
Thank you very much, Navid. I'm delighted. So I'm Karen Middleton. I'm the Chartered Society of Physiotherapy Chief Executive. So I'm responsible for the management of the organisation, which is the UK's professional body for physiotherapists and trade union. We perform two functions. And I've been at the Chartered Society for 5 years. Previously, I was the Chief Allied Health Professions Officer for England, so I was responsible for all the other allied health professions as well as physiotherapy in England. And I am a registered physiotherapist still, although my scope of practice is now leadership and management, and I don't have any clinical practice.
Okay, and also you have been awarded CBE honor. Could you please explain why you have received that? And I know you're doing very, very well with all different activity, but this is a special honor.
Yes, the CBE is a national award given by the Queen, and I was awarded that in 2012 for my work in healthcare. And for allied health professions across England.
Okay, well, congratulations once again.
Thank you.
As I explained briefly earlier, this TV program, which is kind of, you know, its own way special because it's presented by a physiotherapist, and today it's going to be more special because two physiotherapists will discuss these issues. And we have covered so many different subjects, from different clinical conditions to neurological, respiratory, ethical issues, political, health and politic, and public health, you name it. But today I would like to get your opinion briefly about some other issues, such as how exactly, for instance, organizations such as CSP try to increase and enhance the standards of profession?
So the Chartered Society is a membership organisation. Most of our income comes from members who join the Chartered Society, and we have 58,000 members. The Chartered Society performs two functions. So we are a trade union, so we support members in their employment and work on enhancing people's employment conditions, terms and conditions. Yeah. But we also have a role as the professional body for physiotherapy in the UK, and we set standards in terms of education and profession, and professional practice. And we work very closely in a relationship with the Health Professions Council, mm-hmm. which is the organisation in the UK that you have to register with, who you get your licence with in order to practice.
Yes.
And higher education institutes such as universities. And the three of us work very closely together to accredit universities who want to deliver physiotherapy education. So that's really at the beginning of our role in terms of ensuring good clinical practice and professional standards for physiotherapists. But throughout our members' career and their practice, we're there to support members in their professional practice. So we provide guidance. We provide a professional advice service where members can just ring us up mm-hmm. and we will provide them with advice about clinical practice or point them in the right direction. We get very involved at a very national level with organisations such as NICE, the National Institute yes. for Clinical Excellence, when they deliver and provide guidance around healthcare delivery. We get involved in areas where physiotherapy has a place, and also more national policy around healthcare and how it's delivered in this country and the place that physiotherapy can play in improving the health and well-being of the nation. So very much the professional arm of the Chartered Society is involved in that part.
Okay, thank you very much. Can you please explain a little bit more about CSP's relation with universities? How are you going to control if they are reaching or they are at the high standard?
Yeah, so we have a team of staff who go in and work with the HCPC, the Health yes. Professions Council, and the university to accredit the course. If they don't reach the standards that we expect, then they do not get accreditation. And it's reviewed every few years mm-hmm. Through an assessment process. And we keep very closely in touch with the universities about developing their programs to evolve to meet the needs yes. of the profession and what the population needs from physiotherapy. So it's not as if we wait until that accreditation process uh-huh. before there's a conversation. It's an ongoing relationship, but there are points at the beginning of a program being set up and throughout where we assess formally whether it's fit for purpose.
Well, in beginning of your career as a CEO of CSP, you came with a couple of new and very good ideas, such as good to great and having work towards getting physios in general practitioner to as a first contact physio, and also lots of other activities such as love activity, hate exercise. Could you please give us some information about this few subjects that you're dealing with?
So Good to Great was a program of change that I introduced within the CSP. So the Chartered Society has approximately 130 to 140 staff mm-hmm. based around the UK. So we have four offices, one in London, one in Cardiff, one in Belfast, and one in Edinburgh. And we also have a lot of staff who work from home. And my observation and my assessment when I joined the Chartered Society was that we were doing pretty well, hence the good, but I thought we could be really better. Much, much better, so great. So I wanted to take the organisation from where it was to being something really, really excellent to support members in their work. And I felt that it needed to be more modern, it needed to be much more like a business in how we do things. We're not for profit, we're there mm-hmm. as a member-led organisation. But there was something for me about modernising and using systems technology to improve the way we work. So examples of things that we changed was the governance arrangements, which I can talk about in a bit more depth, which was how members really govern the organisation. We have developed what we call a localism agenda, yes. which is in response to what I heard from members was that the CSP felt very London focused. Uh-huh. And we have pushed staff to be out much more on a daily basis, but also less requirement for staff to work in London or in one of the four big offices. There was something about raising the profile within the organisation of policy in order to influence national healthcare policy better, yeah. which we changed. So it was a whole load of things that we changed. Also, the culture of the organisation, it had been quite hierarchical, and I needed to change it so that I could empower the really talented staff to sort of make their own decisions. And so that was the Good to Great programme, which was very much internally focused.
And more towards the structure of
of the actual organisation. Yeah. But I think that lots of members have said to me, it feels different. So I think although it was internally focused as a change programme, it has had an impact on how members perceive the CSP. Mm-hmm. It certainly had an impact on our ability to influence national policy. So an example would be the first contact physiotherapy, which you describe, which has always been something that I have wanted to see. I started in my previous career, previous job, working on self-referral to physiotherapy, mm-hmm. so that as in private practice in this country, I wanted to see a situation where if a person needed physiotherapy, they didn't have to go through a doctor, that they could just, you know, ring up the physio and be seen. But first contact physio was the next step for me. And what's that? What that's about is physiotherapists, advanced practice physiotherapists working in the general practice, who see people with musculoskeletal problems as the first point of contact. They may not have an ongoing relationship with that patient. Mm-hmm. They may not carry on treating that patient, but they will refer them to physiotherapy if it's needed, refer them into secondary care if surgery is needed.
Or for MRI or scans
or blood tests or whatever. Mm-hmm. But what we found is that so many patients, if they see a physio first, actually, many of them don't need to be referred anywhere else. They just need advice, reassurance on what the problem is. So for me, first contact physio is about the person with the best skills in the right place at the right time, seeing the patient as early as possible.
Exactly.
So we have been able to influence national policy to really get the NHS England and the Welsh Assembly, the Scottish Government, and now the Northern Ireland administration to really see that actually this is not only a great thing for patients, a great thing for the public and for physiotherapists, but also in a climate when recruiting general practitioners is really hard, it really works for the system as well, because primary care is obviously the first point of contact that a patient has with the health service. And if patients can't get appointments in primary care because there aren't enough GPs and there's too much work, then they'll just turn up at A&E in a hospital. Yeah. And that's totally inappropriate. So it works for the system and it works for patients and the public. And it's great for the physiotherapy profession, because what it's saying is we are autonomous practitioners. Mm-hmm. We don't need a referral from a medical colleague. But on the other hand, we're working alongside our medical colleagues if and when we need them.
Yeah.
And we've started with musculoskeletal because that's where the data is. And most of the public understand that physiotherapy has a role in musculoskeletal. But I can see that we're going to roll it out beyond musculoskeletal. I think once the public, once general practice, once the system understands that physiotherapists are autonomous practitioners with advanced skills, then I think I can see that expanding. And then the other piece of work has been love activity, hate exercise. And that was that came about because obviously, as in the whole of the world, we have a situation where people are living longer, but they're not necessarily living healthier lives. And with the obesity, so-called epidemic, diabetes, etc., etc., where does physiotherapy have a role? And we said clearly it's around getting people to exercise more. So we did, but there are lots of people involved in the whole exercise world. Yeah. So what's the unique contribution that physiotherapists bring? So we did lots of focus groups with patients, with families, with the public, and with physiotherapists working in this field. And what became clear is, albeit there are lots of people involved in getting people to exercise more and be more active, the unique contribution of physiotherapists is that we understand how important exercise and activity is. We know how to get people to do more, but we also understand when people have a long-term condition, the problems, the issues, we understand the pathology, we understand the limitations. And so what we started to work up was a way of getting people to think about being more active without necessarily using the word exercise, because what we found with people with long-term conditions, if a physiotherapist spends time with them and talks about you need to do more exercise, what they think of is going to a gym, putting on Lycra, and it turns them off, and they actually don't go back. Whereas if we talk about being more active and finding activities that they actually like doing, we will achieve the same endpoint, but a different way. And so that's why we started with the love activity, hate exercise with a question mark, because the statement is really saying, if you like being active but you don't like exercise, that's okay. We can still get you to be fit and improve your health and well-being. And so coming back to influencing national policy, Public Health England, the other public health organisations in the UK are really clear that we have got to get this nation being more active in order to improve health and well-being. And so we have got a place at the table as a result of our Love Activity campaign. And we've just heard that Sport England want to sign a contract with us because they can see that they need to perhaps not focus so much on the sport, but talk about activity, which will then lead people to sport, lead people to exercise.
Well, I like the way you raised this point with passionate character, and I really appreciate your advice. I'm sure our viewer will enjoy that as well. Regarding to first point contact, I would like to mention that unfortunately in many countries around the world, somehow the physiotherapy is not still in the same standard that in European countries, and therefore we see so many people go spend so many times with other specialists, and finally after a couple of weeks or sometimes after months they come back to physio, which if they had gone through straight away or within a few days or a few weeks, it was much different outcome. Is the CSP providing its own policy for national health or other organization as well, or no, just give some advice?
So when I first went to work in the civil service in my previous job, so when I first worked for the government in England, for example, it was very much the politicians who were running or setting the policy for the health service. And that's still true in the other three UK countries. In England now, it's now been devolved down to NHS England. But for me, what you have to work out when it comes to influencing policy is work out who is setting the policy. So it might be politicians, but it might not be. It might be civil servants. It might be general practitioners, for example. So it could be a whole range of people, but there's something about mapping out who are the people who are making the decisions? Who are the people who have got the money? Then there's something about building relationships with those people. And that takes time. And it's difficult if they change as well, because you could build a relationship and then they move on and somebody new starts. So it's got to be a constant building of relationships so that you build that trust.
Yes.
I think it's also about understanding their priorities. So, for example, the Chartered Society of Physiotherapy is apolitical. So what we mean by that is that we are not a political organisation. We don't affiliate to one of the political parties, because our view is that we have to work with whichever government is in power. But what we do is learn and understand what their priorities are. And whilst we try and influence the priorities, once they've been set, then we have to shape what our priorities are for the profession.
And for patients.
And for patients, and try and influence
them
that way. Okay. And I think what we have been successful over the last few years, or why we've been successful, is that our priorities have pretty much aligned with the government's priorities.
Okay.
So where they're needing help,
it aligns
with us. And I think the other thing is bringing other parties with you. So, for example, First Contact Physiotherapy, we would not have achieved what we've achieved if we weren't working very closely with the Royal College of General Practice and the British Medical Association.
Exactly.
Because if they were resisting,
it wouldn't work.
So we have had to work very hard on those relationships and taking it forward together. So I think policy influencing has been very much about the relationships you build. The other side to it, and this was a change when I came to the Chartered Society of Physiotherapy, is that we had lots of data and lots of research about the clinical impact of physiotherapy, which of course is fantastic. But actually, in a world where demand for physiotherapy or demand for healthcare is outstripping supply, money is critical.
Yeah.
So a lot of our modelling and our work has been about demonstrating the economic value of physiotherapy. So, for example, if a patient sees a first contact physio as opposed to a GP, what's the difference in price?
Mm-hmm.
It's cheaper.
Yes.
If a patient sees a first contact physio instead of a GP, they're less likely to be prescribed medicines, which are expensive. So that saves money. And also, if people see a first contact physio instead of a GP, they're more likely to return to work quicker. So we have talked about the economics of physiotherapy as much as we talk about the clinical outcomes.
And all of this, of course, needs a great leadership and management, which you have all this skill, and I'm sure you're achieving all of this
with a great team.
Objective.
With a great team.
We don't work without a great team, especially the council and all committees. They're really amazing. Now, Karen, we are reaching the end of the program very quickly. I have so many other questions which are left. The only question I would like to ask, what is the CSP vision for the future?
Well, our next big piece of work that we're working on is community rehabilitation.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of the focus on healthcare policy in this country has been about saving lives. Stroke is a really good example.
Yes.
People are living with stroke better than ever. We've really improved our stroke services from that point of view. But actually, what's the point of living if you're not going to live a really good life? And so we're focusing very much on the rehabilitation, whether it's stroke, whether it's post-head injury, pulmonary rehab, rehab for children. We're really focusing on rehab, and not so much the rehab that goes on in hospital, because that's visible and people know about that, but actually and at home. What happens in people's homes? Where's the rehab there? Because often that's invisible. So that's our next big campaign. To see a really strong focus from on rehabilitation.
I'm sure it will be benefiting many patients. Okay, dear Karen, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Appreciate you attended this program, and I'm sure our viewer will be appreciating that as well. I wish you all the best, thank you very much for sharing your view with our sharing your thought with our viewers. Have a lovely time, and thanks again.
Thank you.
We are reaching the end of the program. Thanks again, my guest, and I wish you all the best. See you next week.